Let's talk about the rules of convergence of sequences and the associated limit laws. Now, much of this material should be very familiar to you because it's really the same thing that we talked about when we talked about limits of functions back at the beginning of the first semester. So, first we'll start with a rough, hand-wavy definition. We'll say that a sequence, A1, A2, A3, and so on, we say that it converges to L, and converges to L and the limit as n goes to infinity of an equals L mean the exact same thing. It converges to L if an gets closer and closer and closer to L as n goes to infinity. In other words, whenever n is large, an has got to be close to L. But the question is, how close is close? And how large is large? So we're going to refine this rough definition, and we're going to make a precise definition. So the precise definition, actually, let me go back a second. How close is close? We use the Greek letter epsilon to signify the how close we want to get. So we're going to say something happens for each epsilon. So you should always think whenever you see an epsilon, this is how close we need to get. And how large is large? We're going to denote it with a letter n. So the precise definition of convergence is that we say that this limit is L if for any epsilon, so you tell me how close you want to be. If you want to be within a tenth, then epsilon is a tenth. If you want to be within a millionth, then epsilon is a millionth. If for any epsilon, there's an integer n such that after the first n steps, you are within epsilon of L. Okay? So the idea is we've got this sequence, and it's bouncing around, and maybe it seems to be getting close to a certain number, and eventually it's within a tenth of that number. That's good enough if epsilon is a tenth, but we had to be able to do it for any epsilon. So if you come back and say, I don't want to just be within a tenth, I want to be within a hundredth, then a while later, we discover that we're within a hundredth. You want to be within a thousandth? Well, eventually, you settle in within a thousandth. So you always have this neighborhood of L. You have all the points from L to L plus epsilon and L minus epsilon. The idea is no matter how small epsilon is, the sequence eventually lands in this little strip and stays there. Okay, so that's the precise definition. Now let's talk about what the limit laws are. And the limit laws for sequences are just like the limit laws for functions. So let's suppose we have one sequence, A1, A2, A3, that goes to L, and another sequence, B1, B2, B3, that goes to a different number, M. And let's suppose that C is a constant. Then the limit of an plus bn is going to be L plus m. That's just like the statement that the limit of f of x plus g of x is the limit of f of x plus the limit of g of x. And the reason is the same. If an is really close to L and bn is really close to m, you take a number close to L and add it to a number close to m, and you're going to get close to L plus m. And if you take the difference, you're going to get a number close to L minus m. And if you take the product, you're going to get a number close to L times m. And if you take the ratio, you're going to get a number close to L over m, as long as you're not dividing by a number that's close to zero. And finally, if you multiply a by a constant, you get if a is close to L, then c times a is close to c times L. So these are our five limit laws. If a and b each converge, then A plus B converges, A minus B converges, A times B converges, A over B converges, and a constant times A converges. So let's state that explicitly. If we have two sequences and they are both convergent, then so are their sum, their difference, their product, their ratio, as long as you're not dividing by things that are close to zero, and the multiple of the first one. Okay? Now, with that under our belt, let's look at some more definitions. So a sequence is bounded if it doesn't get too big. That means it doesn't get too positive and it doesn't get too negative. If there's a sequence that never gets bigger than 1,000 and never gets smaller than minus 1,000, it's bounded by 1,000. We say it's bounded, period, if there's some number, if it's bounded by 1,000 or maybe it's bounded by 1,000,000, but it doesn't get arbitrarily big and it doesn't get arbitrarily small. We say it's strictly increasing if each term is bigger than the previous term. For a second, forget about this part. It's strictly increasing if each term of the sequence is bigger than its predecessor. We say it's strictly decreasing if each term is less than its predecessor. So the idea is either you're always going up, or you're always, which is strictly increasing. Strictly decreasing is always going down. Non-decreasing is almost the same thing. Non-decreasing means you don't go down. You don't have to go up. If you take the numbers 1, 1, 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 3, 4, 4, and so on, that's non-decreasing. When you go from 3 to 3, you don't go up, but at least you're not going down. And similarly, non-increasing means you don't go up. Monotonic is an important word. Monotonic means it's either non-decreasing or non-increasing. It's like driving down a one-way street. So you go drive down the one-way street, you always go in one direction, or sometimes you stop. You don't have to always be going forwards, but you can never be going backwards. Now, you notice I didn't say that anything was increasing or decreasing. And that's because different authors use the words increasing and decreasing in different ways. Some use increasing to mean non-decreasing. So then there's increasing and strictly increasing. Some people use it to mean strictly increasing. So to them there's increasing and non-decreasing. So I prefer to use strictly increasing when it's strict, when each term is bigger than the one before, non-decreasing when each term is at least as big as the one before, and I try to avoid the word increasing because it is a little bit ambiguous. Okay. So here's the big theorem about monotonic sequences. If a sequence is monotonic and bounded, it automatically converges. We'll see why in a minute. But a warning, if a sequence is not bounded, it always diverges. And if it's bounded but not monotonic, sometimes it converges, sometimes it diverges. So for example, if it's unbounded, then eventually it'll get either bigger than a gigantic number or smaller than a really negative number. So it can't settle down to a number, or else it couldn't possibly get these, or else it would be bounded. So if it's unbounded, it automatically diverges. If it's bounded but not monotonic, if it goes up and down and up and down, well, it may never settle down. Or maybe it goes up and down and up and down and up and down and does settle down. So there are bounded sequences that are not monotonic that converge. There are bounded sequences that are not monotonic that diverge. So why do monotonic bounded sequences converge? Let's look at increasing sequences. So we've got numbers that are getting bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. And it's bounded, so these numbers never get bigger than m. So there are two possibilities. Either they eventually get close to m, and if they get close to m, then they're trapped because they can never go back down again. They're increasing or non-decreasing. So once they get close to m, they stay close forever. So either they get close to m or they don't. If they don't get close to m, then we replace m with a smaller number and see if they get close to that. If they don't get close to that, replace it with a smaller number. With that kind of reasoning, you see, if it keeps going up, the increases have to peter out because it can't grow forever. And wherever it peters out, that's the limit. Maybe it's all the way at m, maybe it's some smaller number. If it keeps increasing and doesn't go off to infinity, it has to have a limit.